Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.
I want you to turn with me to two different scriptures. I want us to go first to, well, we're going to go to three scriptures and just read them, all right? Let's go to Philippians chapter 4. Let's go there first. Philippians chapter 4. And I want you to look with me in verse 11. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 11. We'll read 11 and 12. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I don't think that man had ever lived in Alabama. No, I'm just kidding. Hey, man, Alabama's a good state. You got to have something to step on when you go into Mississippi. All right. I'm just playing. How many from Alabama? Raise your hand. Let's see all the Alabama. Hey, man, I love y'all. You know I do. Amen. All right. All right. But he says, in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased and how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. Of course, we all know verse 13, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Now, keep your hand in Philippians right there, and I want you to turn with me to 1 Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 6. Notice again what he said, and I'll give it to you while you're turning there. But he said that I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. Then in 1 Timothy chapter 6, look with me down in verse 6. He said, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and have pierced themselves through with many sorrows. He tells young Timothy, but thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. Now, let me give you one other verse. Go with me, and you can keep your hand there in 1 Timothy if you'd like to, but let's go to Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. We often quote verse 4 about marriage. Marriage is honorable and all, and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. But verse 5 is where I want us to get to. The Bible says in verse 5, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. We understand the reason that's so important is the Lord is saying, you know, the truth is really all you need is me. All you need is me. What Jesus said, Jesus is everything that me and you need. Now, he does give the contrast right there with covetousness and contentment. Those two things are polar opposites. One side, the contentment side, is one thing. The covetousness side is another. One of the definitions they gave of contentment was inner sufficiency that keeps us at peace in spite of outward circumstances. That's about right, isn't it? I mean, I'm glad the Lord, like they were singing a minute ago, he's the eye of the storm. That's what he's talking about, that contentment, that peace that you can have in the midst of the storm. But the battle that rages, or that Satan, I guess, has tried to set up from the beginning, has always tried to keep me and you discontent. He doesn't want us content, like the Bible says, with such things as you have. He doesn't want us to be content with the matter of godliness with contentment is great gain. He doesn't want us content with being godly and living a godly life. And you understand, he's not satisfied with that. What he wants is he wants us to spend our life after something that really doesn't mean anything.
Right, amen.
Now, this is not a message on money, just on money or making money. You think covetousness, we immediately, and the Bible does link it there. He talks much about riches with that. That is probably one of the biggest forms of covetousness, but there's a lot of things that you can covet. The first sin that was ever committed in the Garden of Eden, back in Genesis, this morning I was teaching the teenagers, and we were dealing with temptation, and we were talking about how Eve was tempted and how Satan came into that perfect garden with a perfect man and a perfect woman, a sinless man and a sinless woman, and was able to convince them that the very one thing that God said you don't need, that was the one thing that they had to have. And imagine all those trees. I preached on that this morning. All those trees in the garden, all that fruit they could eat. Yeah. And he said, there's one tree. It wasn't even a grove. It wasn't even a big, like a whole bunch of trees all together. There's one tree. And whatever fruit was on it, but he said, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for the day that you eat of it, thou shalt surely die. But what the devil did is, Satan did, it when I was dealing with him with this matter of temptation, we talked about how to be tempted with something, you got to come in contact with it. I mean, you have to have seen it, you have to know about it. Somehow you come into contact with something, and so now it's in your brain, it's in your knowledge. Well, the fact that it's there, and then like that, when the fact that God said, well, yes, there is something like that there, but I don't want you doing it. Well, Eve went to contemplating on it. So if there's contact, then there's contemplation. She went to thinking about it. She went to dwelling on it. Look, and I just tell you, it's not good to be dwelling on things that are not right in the sight of God. Amen. Dwelling on things that God doesn't want you to dwell on, to think about. The Bible tells us what to think on. Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report. If there's any virtue, if there's any praise, and he goes on, think on these things. Boy, he lays that out. But if we're not careful, boy, we can get, our mind seems to wander, doesn't it? It gets across the fence, if you will. But it's not just the matter. You say, well, there's nothing wrong as long as you think it, but you don't do it. Well, can I just say, it's wrong to think it. Yeah. I mean, it's not right to think it, if you will. But they came in contact with it. Then there's that contemplating of it, that thinking about it. But then that created the craving for it. Now, that craving is what the Bible speaks about when it uses the word lust. The word lust, and immediately when we say lust, we think of things with a man and with a woman. But the truth is, there's many, many things that people can lust after. When you ask a young person, what do they want to be? What do they want to have out of life? Well, the things they start naming are, well, I want riches. Well, I want fame. Well, and boy, they're naming things, but these are not things these things are temporary. I mean, think about it. I remember Brother Joshua Boatwright, my buddy that pastors up there at Legacy Baptist Church, and how he said, preacher, because he was the BMX rider on the bicycle, and boy, he was on the ESPN and all of that, and on TV, and he said, man, I've been to Tahiti, and he said, stayed in like the King's Palace or whatever the guy, the presidential palace over there in Tahiti. He said, that's where they put us. He said, literally, we just hung out with the prince while we were there. But he said, man, my name was here. And he said, boy, people knew me there. And you said Boatwright. And everybody knew, that's that bike rider. But he said, man, that was the emptiest I've ever been in my life. And you would think, wait, your name, everybody knows your name. You could YouTube Joshua Boatwright and you'll see him riding a bicycle and jumping and turning. But he said, that was the emptiest I've ever been. The emptiest. you speak to people and begin to talk with them about money. And usually, here's what you hear. From those that have no money, they're like, man, I tell you, if I had money, I'm telling you, it would fix so many problems I've got. I mean, man, let me tell you, I've got these problems, and they all center around finances. And, man, if I just had money, if I had all this unlimited money, I tell you what it would do. It would just fix every problem I have. It would fix I wouldn't have to have any more debt, and that's my biggest problem. Debt's not your biggest problem. Now, debt's a problem. I'm not going to kid with you. But debt's not your biggest problem. You see, because you have all the money in the world, just like that fellow had all the fame that he could want, and still be as empty. Amen. As empty as an empty glass. You understand? Because if we're not careful, we honestly think, see, we're empty, we're empty by nature anyway. And we try to fill that emptiness. So that's what a lost man does. A lost man tries to fill his emptiness with things. He thinks, well, if I do enough of this, it'll make me, maybe I'll run after pleasure for a while. And boy, if I can do what I want and live like I want, then I'll be happy. And boy, that'll fill me. That doesn't fill you. That makes you more empty. Is that right? Well, I'll tell you what, we pick these different things, and if we go after that and we go after this, then that's going to make me happy, and that's going to make me happy. Can I tell you this? The only thing that will ever fulfill any man, woman, boy, or girl on this planet is the Son of God. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ. And it seems like a simple answer. You would think that everybody would, oh, preacher, well, everybody knows that. And preacher, we're in church. We're born-again Christians sitting here tonight. But can I help you with something? If we're not careful, some of the most covetous people that have ever lived have been Christians. Now, what I want to show you, and I want to help you with this matter of contentment, because contentment versus covetousness, these scriptures that I just read to you, they begin to reveal some things to you. As you see, because covetousness is very deceiving. There's people that can be covetous and not even realize it, not be consciously aware of it. Just because you've got that mindset, and all of a sudden now you begin to think like that, and you begin to want and crave, and all of a sudden you find yourself in your life every day you get up and you've got different cravings other than what God wants for your life. You've got different wants than what God wants. You begin to shift the purpose God has and say, well, then I think maybe God's purpose for me is to go this way instead of God's purpose for my life or God's plan for my life. I just tell you this, the greatest thing you could ever do would be to live slap dab in the middle of the will of God. I mean, brother, find the will of God, follow the will of God, and just be fruitful in the will of God all of your life. I mean, that would be the best life you could ever have. Girls, you're not going to fulfill your life by getting married to some guy one day. Now, that's a blessing, and that's a great part of it when you get married. But that's not contentment. Contentment is having Jesus first and then having that fella, you know, if you're a girl, having that fella on your arm, amen. Now, if you're a guy, you have a girl on your arm. Say amen right there. Guys have girls on their arms and girls have guys on their arms. And, if you're married, that's the way it's supposed to be. And that's a good thing right there. But that is not the goal of contentment is, well, if I can finally just get married, then I'll be all right. I know plenty of people that are married that are not content. So it can't just be in, well, I got a ring on my finger. Man, I'm content. You might be content for a week or two, but I tell you what you better do. Jesus better get first in your life. Right. We better put Jesus back where he wants to be. And you know the truth is, where we want him to be. Yeah. How easy does Terrell Hopkins let things get in between him and Jesus? Now, I don't know about you. Maybe you're not that way. Maybe you're a whole lot better Christian than I am. Maybe you're a whole lot closer to the Lord than I'll ever be. But I'll tell you what, I find that Satan finds it real easy to put things between me and my Savior. And I find myself, truthfully, on a daily basis, having to move things back out of the way and to put Jesus first. That's not something I just do during revival once a year. That's not something I'm going to do at camp next week. That's not something you got to do that every single day of your life. Now, I want you to, let's look back in Philippians. You were there in Philippians when we started. I was about to read to you in Genesis. Let me at least read it to you, how her covetousness, you can see it. Satan's talking to her. And the serpent asked her about the tree. She said, oh, I can't eat of that tree. You can't touch it, lest you die. Verse 4, he said, you shall not surely die. And verse 5, for God doth know that the day that you eat thereof, your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Here's her problem. Notice what she began to look at that fruit in a wrong way. See, she used to look at God like, God, you're all I need. But now she's about to look at this fruit. The Bible said, when she saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now, in a minute, though, God doesn't put up with that, this covetousness. And they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called, and Adam said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, the woman that thou gavest to me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. Everybody's shifting the blame, throwing it somewhere else. But what I'm reading here is the fall of man, the fall of sinless humanity at one time. Now, I said this morning, if Satan could walk into a garden with a sinless man and a sinless woman, what sin did he use to get them with? What sin did he attack the sinless man and the sinless woman with? What sin did he go in with adultery? Did he go in with murder to begin with? No. A lot of things came from the fall, but you understand, no. He used covetousness. Right. I want that. It's good for fruit. It's a tree to make one, it's a fruit to make one wise. I mean, he used covetousness. Now, I just say, if Satan is smart enough to know that I need to use covetousness to get this sinless man and sinless woman, what do you think he's going to use in our life to attack us? Now, when I read this here, and again, I'll not go back, but if we read in Exodus chapter 20 and verse 17, that's where the Lord said, he said, thou shalt not covet. And he names all those things you ought not be coveting. He said, you ought not want that which is not yours. In other words, you ought to be content. You ought to be happy. You ought to be satisfied with what you got. And can I tell you, when I read my Bible, I just say this, with us as Christians, let's be satisfied with our ministry. Say amen. I mean, when I say our ministry, as a pastor, I don't want to ever be satisfied. I want to see more people saved. I don't mean that. I want to see more people get in. I want to see more lives change. I want to do all I can for God in the days that I have and reach everybody that we can by the grace of God. But the Lord puts you in a ministry. God puts you in, and I'm talking about not just in this church. I'm talking about in a ministry that you're in. Are you in the bus ministry? God puts you in the bus ministry. You in the nursery, God put you in the nursery. You in Awana, God put you in Awana. What ministry are you in? Who put you to doing what you were doing? The Lord did. Now, God put you to doing that, you know what he wants you to do? He wants you to be grateful that he's allowing you to do that. He wants you to be thankful that he has put you into the ministry. Like Paul said when he said, I thank my God who hath counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. But I just say this, if people got satisfied with the ministry they're serving in, they wouldn't be ministry hopping. You wouldn't have to be jumping from the bus ministry to this one, that one, to that one. You wouldn't have to do that because you'd be like, man alive, you know what? Truth is, I love it. I there's not a day I don't get calls about something, all right? There's not a day that people don't call and say, preacher, and they're laying out something or they're telling me I had someone call me today. And of course, you know, it's going to be like right before I preach. And I mean, that's just the way it happens sometimes, you know. But it's a call. Preacher! And they're telling me about, a matter of being satisfied, how they're not satisfied and when it starts like that, I already know where it's going. You know, well, we're not satisfied. Well, we need this. Well, I feel this. Well, I think that. And it went on. And at the end, they told me what they were doing and what they were thinking about. And And that the thing was contentment. It was contentment. I'm preaching on this, so I guess the Lord was giving me an illustration, I guess. I don't know. But I got that. So I'm sitting there, and I tried to help them with that. Because I used the ministry here at the church. I used the church. I said, all right. I said, but can I help you with something? I said, my advice would be this. I said, if you got faithful, I mean faithful, Sunday school, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, you became faithful in your attendance. And I mean, buddy, you just came because you got to come. You know, you just got to be there. Yep. So if you became faithful in your attendance, I said, and you got involved in the work of God. Involved. I mean, you got in a ministry, something where you're giving out to others. I mean, now they're counting on you. Hey, brother, you're ministering, you're working, you're serving. I said, if you did that for 6 months, I said, you'd be as content as anybody you've ever seen. And that's the truth. When people are involved in a work, I have the same thing when people come to me with their marriage. Preacher, I'm not content with my marriage. I'm not content with who I'm married to. I'm not content with the situation. I'm not content with what's going on. I'm not content with the past. I'm not content with what's going to be in the future. I'm not content with my marriage. And now, what do you think my advice is? I'll tell you what you need to do. Go find about 4 or 5 people and date around. That's not the advice I'm going to give. Oh, I'll tell you what you do. You know, because, I mean, you know, you're not content. And so the way to fix that is, man, get away from whoever you're with, because, I mean, you're not content. And so go find somebody else. You're like, preacher, if you gave that advice to my spouse, I'd kill you. Because then I just gave him a license to sin, amen. No, you know what I tell somebody? You know what I have told when I sit down with couples? Like, I tell you what you do and begin to talk to them. I find out, here's what I find out, they're not content. They're not spending a whole lot of time with each other. And they're not doing a whole lot of things together. Amen. And when they are together, they're not even really talking. And when they're not, and so you got a situation where you got two people living in the same house, or they live in separate rooms. And you wonder why they're not content. And then all of a sudden, but I would tell them, I tell you what I want you to do. And I'd prescribe to them how to come home and how to sit down and how to see each other and how to put other things to the side and make time and just do. And I would say, by the way, I don't want you just in the presence of the other one. I said, I would tell them for the next 6 months, I want you to invest yourself. I tell that man, you invest everything you have into your wife. And then you might say this. I'm going to invest everything in this woman. I'll talk to this woman. I'll spend time with this woman, my woman. Amen. I mean, because that's what you do. That's what's right. Don't go look somewhere else. Why not just fix what you got? See, the problem is, well, I tell you what, we don't want to put in the work. It takes a lot of work to stay content with what you have. Takes a lot of work to stay content. I don't care if it's in the church you're in. I don't care if it's on the job you're on. I don't care if it's with the husband you have, with the wife you have, with the family you have, with the life you have. But when you begin to talk to people, all of a sudden they're not content. I talked to a foolish woman one time. I know that's a rare thing, a foolish. But I talked to a foolish woman one time, and that woman, she was not content because she said, well, this isn't the plan I had for my life. She said, when I got married, she said, I was expecting my husband to keep me up and make us a good living. And I expected us to have this kind of house. And I expected us to be in this kind of car and live in this neighborhood and have this status of life and go on these vacations. And I just listened. And the more she talked, the more foolish she got. Because I'm sitting there thinking, how foolish that this woman, her estimate of what life is about. I said, in my mind, I'm thinking she has put an unreal expectation on that husband. He can never meet that. Because the truth is that when somebody, here's the problem with covetousness is, there's a word that somebody that's covetous never uses. That's enough. They never use those words. They don't, that's enough. I'm good. Got to be something more. Got to have more. Now that was foolishness. And I mean, the Bible says foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child. I told her she's acting like a little girl. I mean, the Bible says it, so I'm just trying to help her. But that was the truth. I said, sister, I hear this kind of talk out on the playground with the kids wanting the most toys. I hear this kind of talk. I said, this isn't the talk of a woman that's got a loving family and children and a home and a husband that loves her. I said, man, your husband works. Your husband goes to church. Your husband, man, he loves the Lord. I started laying out all these other things. It's one of those things where I don't know if she got it then. I don't know if she ever got it. But I'm just telling you, Satan attacks in that. What I see right here is when the Bible tells us, let's notice back with me again. Let's go back to Philippians, if you will. Go to Philippians chapter 4. Because in verse 11, he said, not that I speak in respect of want. He said, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. You know what? It sounds to me like contentment is something that has to be learned. It's not something you just snap your fingers and you're going to get. It's not something that somebody else can tell you, well, you ought to be content. It sounds like that the Lord has to teach us how to be content. You have to realize what contentment is, and then you have to realize a little bit of this about covetousness. And you have to realize that, and by the way, this is not just a matter of things and being rich and being all this. Right. If we're not careful, that covetousness, see, covetousness is the thing that leads to idolatry. Covetousness, when you covet something and you want it bad enough, then that becomes the main thing in your life. And if that's the main thing in your life, then that's your God. If that's your God, that's your idol. If that's your idol, then where's Jesus in all of this? Right. And I'll be honest with you, is there anything more important than Jesus in your life? Should there be anything more important than the Son of God and what He wants with your life right here on this planet? He kind of simplifies it. I've learned that in whatsoever state I am, whatever is going on in my life. Now, that's somebody that is learning to trust God. That's somebody that's learning that God has a plan that God knows about, but that you don't necessarily know about. That means that God may have a path for you that He knows about, but that you don't even know about now. But we learn to trust God with whatever path He puts us on. And we learn to trust God with whatever plan He lays out for us. There's people that go down, there's so many varied paths. We've got people sitting in this church right now. I'm praying for Sister Marchant. She's going to be having the chemo. Man, I'm asking the Lord to touch her. I know she didn't plan that path, but God already knew about that path for her life. But man, you talk to your mama, and she's like, hey, I'm trusting God. God's in control. Man, she's pepping me up while I'm talking to her. Amen. She does you the same way, don't she, buddy? You understand? She's learned that whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. God, then if you're allowing this, the fact that it's in my life, God, then you've allowed it. Then, Lord, I'm going to trust you. And I'm going to walk through this, Lord, because I'm walking through it with you. And I'm kind of getting ahead because I was there. I remember over in Hebrews, that's what he said. He said, I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. In other words, he's linking that contentment with the fact that God is walking with us. We can be content with God's presence in our life. Hey, you can be content with God's provision in your life. But I wanted this, and remember, I wanted that. And the Lord says, no, why don't you just be content? The Lord just said, well, if I got food and raiment, preacher, I got to have more than food and raiment. Don't you know that? I got to have more than clothes on my back and food in my mouth. The Lord just said, if you got food and raiment, he said, let us therewith be content. It almost sounds like it don't really matter which house we live in. If I got food and raiment, let me therewith be content. It almost sounds like it ain't really a big deal, you know, for cars, you know, new or not. It almost sounds like it that the things we put a lot of priority on aren't as important as what God sees. There's no, don't sit here tonight. Now you, somebody, you may have a brand new 2016, whatever, parked out here, whatever. You know, all the cars were new at one time, amen. We bought Miss Hopkins a brand, we bought her, in 1990, December of 1990. I got Miss Hopkins a 1991 Geo Prism. Woo! Man, I mean, we were top notch, son. We was walking on top of the financial ladder. Payments were like $200-something a month. And we thought we were dying. I mean, I'm talking about dying. You know, oh man, no, I'm sorry. Wasn't that, they were 185 or something like that, wasn't it? 135, sorry. See, they're getting less and less. Car wasn't near as nice as I thought it was. But hey, brand spanking new. Now, my wife, she's like a perpetual, in fact, she got mad when we bought the View. She said, I'd still be driving that Prism if you hadn't got rid of it. And it was still running. We saw it like one time, like one of the last times we saw it, it was still running around, amen. But the Lord said, you know, don't put all your stock in that. Not about having it. You live in a nice house, live in it. You live in a good, have a good car, drive it. You have those things, but you understand our problem comes whenever we're not able to say that's enough. But always, well, I want a little more. I gotta have a little more. I gotta have a little bigger. I gotta have a little better. Because but why? Why? When we begin to look at this matter of contentment. What God, really, contentment is linked, just like on the bad side of it, covetousness is on one side, trust in God's on the other side of contentment. Trust in the Lord. I mean, your faith in God, your faith in the Son of God. See, we ought to be satisfied with God's presence. We ought to be satisfied with God's provision. We ought to be satisfied with God's power. We ought to be satisfied with God's placement in our life. He said that I have learned in whatsoever state I am. Lord, wherever you put me, then I'm going to be content. Can you be content? Look, I was content when I got in church and they let me be the doorman on the bus. I was content when they let me be, and then they said, well, we want you to be a bus captain. I was content. Man, this is great. I was content when I was over the Sunday school. I was content when I was an assistant pastor. I was not one of these, oh man, I tell you, I can't wait till I'm going to go pastor. I'm going to do it. And man, I'm ready at the bit, so I'm going to get out of here. No, I was like, man, I got it made and I know it. Woo, man, hey, Preacher Moore, he's the pastor. He's got all the burdens, all the headaches, all the heartaches, and he has to deal with all of that. You know what I got to do every day? Come in here, go knock on doors, work around the church. I got it made. So, I mean, but you know what it was? Contentment. Oh, I'm Pastor Hopkins at Heritage Baptist Church. You know what? I'm content, man. I mean, content. Oh, I'll tell you what, well, one of these days, I got preacher friends. I mean, sometimes I think, but here, if you say bless their heart, it's all right to say it, ain't it? Like, bless their heart, but they ain't got a brain in their head sometimes. Yep. I tell you what, and when they start talking about their church, I'm not content. What they're saying is, I'm not content. And so, you know, I just asked them, like, so what do you want? Well, I'll tell you what I want. I'm going to go to another church. And I'm like, you ain't going to be content there either, you old uncontent devil. And finally, I just simplify, you know, they'll talk a little while and they'll say this. I'll say, well, and they'll say, what do you think? I'm like, oh, good. I'm glad you asked. So what do you think? I said, well, I'll tell you what you ought to do. I said, you remember when you first came to that church? I said, how excited you were. I said, remember what you did? All you did is went out and knocked on doors. You had 10 people. Man, you went out and knocked on doors like crazy. You had to. You only had 10 people. I said, knocked on doors, told everybody you could about Jesus. When they all come in, you preached to that 10 like there was 10,000 there. I mean, you just laid it out. I mean, you preached for the right stuff, against the wrong stuff. Man, you just laid it out. And I said, didn't you love it? I said, you were very content when you had 10. And when the church, you know, you didn't have any money. You had no money in that church. I said, you didn't have any. Hey, there was no people in that church, no money in that church. I said, you was content then? I said, what changed, man? Well, I'm like, if we're not careful, I said the best thing we ever had, the best thing we ever had right in front of us. And the truth is, when it comes to your marriage, the best thing you've ever had is right in front of you right now. Amen? And when the truth is, when it comes to your ministry, when it comes to your church, best thing you ever had is right in front of you right now. When it comes to your manner of life, the best thing you've ever had is sitting in front of you right now. I realize that, hey, I got Bridget, David, and Jonathan. They're all still living at home. I'm enjoying that. I enjoy it whether they enjoy it or not. I just make myself enjoy it, you know? I make them enjoy it. Because I realize, hey, I don't stay that way. I look around this church, I got all these families here, and all these older ones, they tell me, preacher, I ain't gonna be that way. And I'm, you know what? I know it. The funnel's going this way, not that way. And so you understand, if that's the case, then enjoy it. Hey, you got them in front of you right now. Daddy, make that home the greatest experience your kids have ever had. Mama, make that home the greatest experience your kids have ever had. Hey, kids, don't ruin it for everybody and have some teenage crazy attitude. Instead, make the home life as awesome as possible. For everybody there. It's hard for you to realize now because you're like teenagers, and then when they go, well, I tell you what, I can get out of this house. I can get out of this house. You know, not content with that. I can get out, though, boy, if I can get out, man, I tell you, that's just going to fix everything. It'll come a day when you'll say, man, amen. Wish I was back over to that house. Things sure were a lot easier then. Man, I didn't have... See, because you get out, you find out, man, there's a whole lot more responsibility than I thought there was. And what I'm saying, hey, I'm talking about contentment. Contentment with the Lord. Contentment with His power, His presence, His provision. What He said, I've learned whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. So I realize, all right, Lord, I can sit around and complain. And in here... The things you have to guard against about this matter of what fights the contentment in your life, of course, the covetousness. That's the main thing, the covetousness. But you'll find yourself, all right, so we don't need to be covetous. Well, then the second is we don't need to be critical. Because when I'm critical, that just means I'm not content. Why would I be criticizing if I'm content? Because if I'm content, I'm not criticizing it. When you're content with your spouse, you're not criticizing them. When you're content with your parents, you're not criticizing them. When you're content with your church members, you're not criticizing. When you're content with your church, with your pastor, you're not criticizing. When you're content, it's amazing how the Lord puts a thankful heart into you and a grateful heart into you. And you become very appreciative of what you've got. And when you're appreciating what you got, it's going to be hard to be real critical about it. It's going to be hard. You're not going to be condemning something you're very thankful and appreciative for.
Right.
Sounds to me like we got to let God work on a little bit of, to help us be content, He's got to work on a little bit of thankfulness. I was thinking about, Miss Tiffany. Miss Tiffany's back there. She's getting ready to go. Her and the kids, they're all heading back up to North Dakota. Amen. They'll be up there. But y'all aren't coming back. Brother Michael's coming back on Wednesday, right? But y'all are staying up there, right? You're not. Oh, you're coming too. Okay. All right. So Wednesday will be y'all's last service, right? All right. She's got thumbs up back there. Amen. But now here, she's gone. Y'all do something for me. Take a microphone back here to her. Take a microphone back here to my sister. She's been gone. She's up there. She's a pastor's wife. It's wonderful. No problems as a pastor's wife. Being a pastor's wife, there's like no stress, no nothing. Ask Melissa Hopkins. It's the greatest thing in the world. Amen. Best thing she'd ever do. Everything she could ever done is married me. I mean, it just took all, it relieved her of all problems in life. But when you're gone from a place, you realize what you had, don't you? Testify about it.
Kind of funny, Michael and I had this conversation not too long ago, shortly after preacher left. We had that same comment, you don't realize what you have until it's gone. Not that Calvary's not a great place. It is. The church is growing, and we're very thankful that the Lord has sent us there. But this has always been home. We have friends and family here that we don't have there.
Right.
We have a lot of people at our church there that are there. They're there without their families.
Yeah.
When we got there, we had about 40 people in the church, and now we have between 90 and 100 on a Sunday morning, which is great. The church is growing.
Amen.
But we're teaching people brand new. They're learning to soul win, and they're learning to become a church family, and we're trying to teach people that what a church family is about.
Right.
I'm very thankful that we have the church family here that we do have, and that we have a church home to come back to when we can come visit and learn here and take it back there. It's not always easy. It's not always easy, but the Lord's been merciful, and he's taught us a lot of things through this journey. I'm very thankful for that.
Amen. Amen. You see, when you realize what you got, then you learn not to be critical about it. You learn to be thankful for it. And so don't be covetous, don't be critical, but then here's what you have to do. You have to be crucified. You have to crucify this old carnal nature of ours that wants to covet. You have to crucify this old carnal nature that gets critical. You have to crucify this old carnal nature that gets unthankful so many times. And then, you know what? Why don't you fix that problem of the problem of not being content? Why don't you, what would it do to a marriage if every husband and every wife went to each other and said, I'm content. I'm happy. I'm satisfied with you. Doesn't mean y'all are perfect people, but you let them know that, hey, I'm, you see, because, they know that. I ain't got to tell them that. Yes, you do. They need to hear it. He needs to hear it. She needs to hear it. And it ought to come out of your mouth because you mean it. I ain't saying that. What are you, so discontent that you won't even say it? So hard-hearted you can't even tell the people you love that you're content with them? Come on. I'd say that sounds like something the Lord needs to change there. See, only the Lord can change that. God, Paul's able to say, I've learned that whatsoever state I am, that I am, therewith to be content. And then he goes, I know how to be both to be abased and to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed to be full, to be hungry. He said, whatever I'm going through, it doesn't matter. He said, I'm going to, and by the way, he said, full or hungry. Through the good times and the bad, to be content. Well, I can be content, preacher, if things are good. I can tell you this, with God's help, you can be content when things are bad. Because I wish I could tell you, I'm sorry, I'm not Joel Osteen. I'm not going to tell you that, you know, every day's a happy day and we're going to have a good day today and it's all good, ain't no bad. I'm not going to tell you that stuff for. Because you go, hey, you're going to face adversity and what the Bible calls affliction. You're going to face the hardships. And I don't want to lie to you as a pastor and paint you some pie in the sky and tell you that's not the way it is. But I can tell you this, the Lord Jesus said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you during all of it. I will walk with you every step through everything you go through. He said, when you're abounding and when you're abased, and when you're full and when you're hungry. He said, I'm there and I'm going to be with you. And I want you, and the Lord's saying to me and you, I just want you to be content with me. And then all I know is when I read that the scripture that we read in Hebrews, I'll give it to you in Hebrews 13:5. But he just said, let your conversation be without covetousness and be content with such things as you have. Be content with the people you have. Be content with the place you have, with the position you have. Be content with the possessions you have. All that. Sounds like the Lord is just, he's just trying to remind us. He said, and be content with such things as you have. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. The Lord just said over and over, I'm with you. I'm all you need. Everything in this life you're going to face, I'll be with you through it. I'll walk with you through it. The scripture that they gave us in 1 Timothy, he said, but godliness with contentment, 1 Timothy 6:6, but godliness with contentment is great gain. Wait a minute. I thought this matter of gain, covetousness is that wanting of wrong gain. But the Lord says, but godliness with contentment, that's great gain. You have gained. You understand the Lord is saying, if you can get a hold of this matter of being content with what I am in your life and who I am in your life and what I've given you in this life, be content with your position, be content with your place, be content with your possessions, be content with all these things. And if you can do that, then godliness with contentment, he says, that person is the person that's gained the most. It's great gain. I don't know about you. I like that. Great gain, son. Woo! I want my... godliness with that contentment is that great gain. And the Lord says we can all have it. That's not something just for the preacher. That's not something just for certain individuals in this church. The Lord said it's available to every single one of us sitting here. Man, I tell you what. Want to be a blessing to go a week. All of a sudden, Lord, I'm just content. And there's no... You're not being critical about anything or anybody. Lord, I'm content. And there's no condemnation of anything or anybody. Lord, I'm content and there's no covetousness. You're not living every day here for more. And here, you've actually, that word enough is stuck back in your vocabulary. You hadn't taken it out. Lord, I'm fine. I'm good. I'm grateful, Lord. I'm thankful. And I tell you, when you get like that, the Lord walks with you. The Lord helps you. It's a message on contentment. I've never just preached on contentment, but I just did. Sounds like the Lord wants us to be content from what I read in my Bible. Sounds like He's enough. Sounds like He's really everything you really need. You know, the best thing we can do when we have a service like this, it might be good just to get on our knees and tell Him again how thankful we are and how grateful. And maybe we need to say, oh God, forgive me for my foolish covetousness. If you need to pray, let's come get in this altar right now. Come on.
Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.